grace. God promised that he would give grace and salvation to those who pray in earnest. He promised grace and salvation. And grace and salvation are conditioned on faith and obedience. You want God to richly bless you. If you want God to bring that peace in your heart and in your life, do you want God to give you rest in your spirit and to keep you from anxiety and fear in these troublesome days? Trust him and obey him. You can't make it happen in the sense that you can do enough. But you make it happen when you exercise faith. Because the Bible says without faith, it is impossible to please God. But they that come to God, Hebrews 11:6, must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And so that forgiveness and restoration follow confession, repentance, and obedience. Forgiveness and restoration. God said in another place, I will restore to you what the locusts destroyed. God can restore health. He can restore misfortune. God can restore a good relationship. You got to have faith. Am I coming through to you? I got to say it to you. You got to have faith in God, but you got to obey him in the things that he offers for our lives. It's just like that. If I knew much more, if I could. I knew how to do this. I knew how. God said, you know how to be obedient. You know how to say yes. You know how to put me first above other things. You know how to evaluate and examine yourself and declare to yourself what your habits and practices that are not good, they are not wholesome, and they are not getting you where you want to be. He said, you're able to evaluate yourself and you're able to admit the truth about your evaluation. And when you are honest and come to me and say it's you, not the other, God say, I bless you. I do it. Oh, what peace we often talk of. Oh, what need this man to be better. All because we don't carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and tribulation? Are we coming to a world of care? Jesus knows our everything. In prayer. Don't talk to your friends, but that would be a crime when you're cut off. You'll do more talking to God than you do to others. Confess to him and act in grace and give you strength to abandon, do away with those things that are hindering God's purpose for your life. And so then, I'm just about on with that, dealing with Solomon and people of Israel. But I want to say something, and I have to jot some of it down because I don't need any more of it, but I want to say something to you, and I want you to take it as preaching. And so that First Community Antioch, we talk about leading as Christ led. We're having lessons on leadership, and we talk about the leadership of Christ, which was personal leadership. Christ determined that God would be the ruler in his life. And all of the shots that would be called in his life would be called by his Father God. And so we talk about personal leadership, that we want to emulate Jesus. We talk about leadership of Jesus, that character was characterized by a servant heart. We talk about servant hearts by ourselves. And we're talking about leadership that is predicated on a sensitive spirit. Be mindful of the feelings and the conditions of others. Leadership that places the Father first and places heavenly and spiritual priorities in perspective. Leadership, we talk about leadership that emphasizes living by kingdom principles. Leadership that recognize that God is the source of power. There is no real power outside of God. There's no lasting power outside of the power that God gives. But we talk about this, but listen to you. This will not automatically happen. My message to you is that you got to make it happen. Wishful thinking, good desires will not make it happen. Abusiveness from authority, right, guilt, and whatever might frighten some folks, but it won't happen. Assassinating policemen or other, that won't make it happen. It didn't happen then. How can it happen? You got to learn how to lean on him. Lean and learn from him. And pray. Study God's word. And stand for that which is right, that which is true. That's how it happens. Lord, I stretch my hand to thee. I give my life to you. And I want to be a servant. I want you to use me for your glory. Whatever the cost, whatever the price, even if it costs my life, I want to live so that many women can see the reality of trusting and serving God. Somebody has to pay the price. And it's unfortunate that these two young men were killed in Minnesota and where was Dallas? Where it was. It's unfortunate. And it's unfortunate that policemen were killed. But notice what is coming out of that. That is a consciousness that has gripped this nation. That we need some help from beyond ourselves. And we see just how quick heart can be snatched away. Our loved ones can be snatched away. That is a consciousness that has gripped our nation. And we realize that we need to do more prayer. We need to do more dialogue and coming together and discussing the problems that we face. Unfortunately, that some had to lose their life. Sometimes tragedy is your good to a better day. You understand what I'm saying? And God has the prerogative to use us as an example of what can happen when a people turn to God. When they stop trying to solve their own problem, they find out that trying to solve their own problem on a mixed pattern of life, we need to stop trusting in ourselves, and this nation needs to turn to God. And stop calling wrong right and right wrong and everything goes and whatever you feel, whatever you like, you go on and do it. God is a God that's against sin, and when a person, a nation turns against God, God turns against it. Am I helping somebody? Listen, then we talk about evangelism. We've been preaching, teaching on evangelism lecture for the last 5 weeks, evangelizing the Lord. But this won't automatically happen. You got to make it happen. When you get up out of your seat and go back to your house and go back to your community and go back to your family, you got to tell somebody about the love of God and the power of Jesus Christ. You got to share the gospel. That's what automatically happens. Put the sign on the church door, on the signboard, saying, "Welcome, come here." There are many who will not come here. Jesus said you have to go back. We must believe the gospel is still the power of God in your salvation. In spite of what we're facing, what we're going through now, we have to believe that the gospel is still beautiful, it's still dynamite, it's still a power of God. The gospel can change what marching won't change. The gospel can change what legislation won't change. We have to believe that the gospel is the power of God. God has given us the remedy for peace and tranquility, for togetherness. He has given, but we have laid them aside. And we have, but the Bible says to Jeremiah, we have upon an unbroken system that can't heal no more. And so then we must show them, listen, we must tell them that the power of God is still present for salvation. But we must also show this power in our own lives. Talk is not enough. Dressing up is not enough. We have to show this power consistently in our own life. We must show this power in our life by the way we walk, by the way we talk. Men and women must see that our fellowship, the fellowship of love. And unity. No time to be bickering with one another. Jesus said, a new commandment I leave with you, that you love one another. Agape. When those in darkness see the church loving and the church serving one another, then the world will take us serious. But as long as we bickering and fussing and fighting, as long as we jockeying for position, as long as we trying to be the big shot, the world won't take us seriously, because the world says that's the same thing we do in our life. Jesus said, if you want to be great, then you need to be a servant. Listen, please. The world must see us obeying Christ in his call for us to feed the hungry, to visit the sick, the widows, to help the orphans. The world must see us serving the elderly. We must rise above our selfish mentality. About me, to simply satisfied when I got food on my table. When my children are doing good. When all of my bills are paid. We must have room in our heart to be concerned for other people. But how am I really concerned? But to be willing, if necessary, to go into a house for one. For one. And pull a little bit out of our savings. To help somebody along the way. That's what Christianity is about. If my people become sensitive to the hurt and the pain and the needs of others and respond. Then after they do that, then that's why I love to give personally, but I love to give from the church. You think God has blessed us and God is blessing us, and the reason why he blessed us is because we have committed ourselves to give. You hear what I'm saying? Take it out from Baton Rouge to New Orleans and see it. Make up a battle. God is blessing us. God is blessing us. Now God knows we're playing in part and we're not playing in part. That's not for me. I don't care for my man. They're talking about how many did you give? How much did that tithe you paid last year? I don't check all of that. But if you rise up, or if you rise up yourself, then I'll check some stuff out. Ready to make noise if you're not doing what you're supposed to do. Am I helping somebody? Where's the wagon family? And so then, thank you. We have to rise up like this, above selfish mentality. Rise up above pettiness. They overlook me. They don't recognize me. I don't like how she looked at me or how she answered me. Rise above that. Rise above that. Did that take any money out of your pocket because she looked at you wrong? Did it affect your health in a negative way because they looked at you wrong? Let folks look at you the way they want to look at you. If you walk with God, if you obey God, if you are faithful in service, God will take care of you. God will provide for you. can either look at what people are doing you, or you can look at what God is doing for you. That's up to you. You control your focus. Love, encouragement, positive, and constructive words. Be a giver. Give your time. Give your service. Give your finances. Give encouragement, though.
Yes, sir.
I was sick and they didn't visit me. How many people did you visit? And they fortunate is not who came to see you, but fortunate is who did you go to see. You want to be more serviceable to God? It won't automatically happen. You have to make it happen. Get out of your comfort zone. Expand your existence. Go beyond your little group. There are only certain people you can function with. Oh, yes, yes, yes. There are only a few people you can get along with. Those who agree with you. And they don't require you change the way you got. They don't require that you be different. If you can be yourself and they still love you, they'll accept you, they'll honor you, they'll worship you, they'll care for you, they'll praise you, and they'll encourage you along the way. But these people will never come into your life because you have shut them out in favor of three or four yes people. Your father used to tell me when he was head deacon at Old Antioch. He said, Reverend, he said, I was a frog that was in a well. And that frog jumped out of the well on the land and he said, look around. He said, my, what a big one. And what he was saying was that some folks are just in a well and they can't see nothing but the four corners of the well. But if you get out of the well, you'll see that there's a great big flood out there. That's beckoning it for you. That God wants your love. That God wants your help. And God has equipped you with the ability to affect this world. In my heaven. But I might fail. The greatest failure that there is not to do anything. And not to try. Not to try is fail. Okay, now let me hurry on here. This, it won't automatically happen. You got to get out of your comfort zone. You got to stop playing the blame game. You got to turn your eyes inward. Now you have already concluded everybody in the world wrong. But now turn your eye inward and evaluate yourself. Listen to the people around you. Listen to the people who know you best. They're not afraid to tell you. And some of them just tell their friends, but who willing and rich, tell them bless you. Good you. Perfect you. That's something that needs to be fixed. Evaluate your own spiritual condition. How strong is my prayer life? How often do I think of others' needs? How many times do I put in reading the word? Take responsibility for making things better in your life. Stop looking to others to validate your existence. Make and take responsibility for making things better in your home. Your home messed up is not because of anybody else. It's because of the folks who are in that home. So take responsibility to make your home better than what it is. Take responsibility to make your job better than what it is. Take responsibility to make your community and your neighborhood better than what it is. Take responsibility for making this ministry, first community and your pastor church, take responsibility for making this ministry better. You're not hearing nothing by complaining and finding faults I don't like when they do this. Let me tell you, I don't like this. I don't like that. It looks like that we ought to be like this. That doesn't. And that doesn't say much for your mentality. Just because you're part of it. All that's wrong with it is you're part of it. Show that you're not going to have as much sense as you think you have. You hold that to yourself, not to me, you hold it to yourself. Take responsibility for making a ministry that you are part of. Well, you're part of the deeper ministry, deeper this, you ought to take responsibility to make it better. If you're not helping it, you hurt it. That goes for every other minister. Stop depending on others to make you feel better about yourself. You got to rise up and talk to yourself. I tell you where you can start. You can start with a psalm and say, no matter what others say, the Lord is my life and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Yeah. And whom shall I be afraid? And when the wicked, even my enemies, come upon me, yeah. I read up my flesh. I'm not worried about it. I won't stay up all night wondering what they're going to do. Whatever they are, they're going to stumble. And they're going to fall completely. Something is not enough. But God said they will not only stumble, but they will be knocked down completely. Talk to yourself.
You want them to make it?
Life is about accountability. Teach them that. Life is about giving back. Life is about giving back. There are people, we are in a selfish age. Young folks are called that I, me. But life is about giving back. You give back to your parents, you give back to your relatives, you give back to the community, you give back to society. Am I helping somebody? Life is about helping others. And so young people, you want to make it, don't you? I understand that. You want to participate in the good life. I understand that. And I'm all for you doing that. But you have to make it happen. It won't automatically happen. You have to set it. You get back on and all this other stuff all day, evening, half of the night. You go to school. Tired. Half aware. Can't comprehend the subject matter. Take the test. Come out with a double F. Go home and tell your parents. That teacher just up like me. That teacher doesn't like slow for me, lazy. It happens to you, but you have to set it. You have to do right, and you have to avoid habits and practices that lead to guilt and regret. You can settle for one night stand, but it may cost you a whole life of misery. You gotta learn how to say no. You gotta learn how to wait. You gotta learn how to buy into the oracles of God. My heavenly God. It won't automatically happen because you think that you're the best gift for the opposite sex. It won't automatically happen. You got to make it happen by embracing the right. Most of all, you must submit to God. God looked upon today this chaotic and confused world, this world of shame and degradation that is becoming increasingly immoral, unethical, and unfortunate. God says to this world, inhabitants, you want a better society? You want a world of justice and equality? World where you're respected, and where your intrinsic value is recognized and accepted by the powers that be. God says you want that. You need to understand that it won't make it happen. You have to make it happen. And so then I asked the Lord, we can have that type of society? He said, yeah. I said, you said we can make it happen? He said, yeah. I said, well, stop. And the Lord spoke and told me, say it's wrong. It's my people. Not the folks of the world. He said, not that world that is being controlled and influenced by diabolical powers. He said, my people. My people. See, the world system works on a majority. He said, I don't need a majority. I just need a rhythm. My people. He said, if my people, if you don't have been washed in my blood, those who sin have been limited, those who have been to the fountain that never runs dry, my people. My people. It is to put that trust in me. Those who are acquainted with my track record, those who can look back and see how I told Adam and Eve and brought them from the tree of life, lest they would live in that sinful body forever. Those who understood about my power. Abraham, who looked for a city that had foundation, who built up and made up with God. My people, like Moses, who struck the rock and water came out of the rock. If my people, like Moses, who shared with you that unbelief, me or y'all, my everlasting home. If my people, people like Isaiah, who spoke of my son as a suffer and servant, my people, who recognize that I got power, like Isaiah, who cried out, if the Lord wants somebody, send me. My people, like Jeremiah, who said that I am a righteous person, my people, who experience the power of my word, when Jeremiah cried out, ah, oh, like fire, shut up in my bones. My people, like Hosea, who allowed me to use him as a demonstration of the faithfulness of the Father. My people, like Amos, who come out the front line and say, and good doing. They're my people. They'll humble themselves from down on their high horses and recognize that it's not about them, it's about me. To recognize that whatever they have and whatever they can do, they're owing to the grace of God. I give them my gift. I give them that gift. I give them that ability. I give them that talent. If they will just come down and not think it, that they're more. But by my spirit, it can happen to my people to humble themselves and then pray. You see, prayer will keep you fit for the battle. Prayer will keep you holding on when there's nothing to hold on to. Prayer, yeah, will let you know that there's a brighter day ahead. Don't pray. Prayer will assure you that God has not forgotten about you, that God can do anything but fail. Prayer will help you understand that your struggle and your situation, your hurt and your pain is only designed to make you strong. Prayer will keep you from complaining. Prayer will lead you to look around and thank things over. Prayer will lead you to conclude that God has been good to you. And that all of your good days outnumber your bad days. Prayer will stop you from complaining. If my people humble themselves, pray, keep my faith, God will start to get out. No matter what your dilapidated situation may be, you automatically get better. You can make it happen. Your presence today, God has spoken to your heart. That be the case with you. You ought to come. I invite you to come. Say yes to the Lord Jesus Christ. You may come by love. You may come by Christian experience. Come as a candidate for baptism. God wants to save you. He wants to restore you to fellowship with himself. Pastor wants to give you a church home, church time. let up. By great permission. It looked like I was preaching another sermon that says, upon this outside, and we definitely would let you go out. Open your Bible. Thank you for the spirit in which we have worshiped today. Use us for the glory of your name. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless all of you again, and the Lord keep you be very careful. Chapter 11 and 4.